every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So today I want to talk about the real you. Who are you? Can you say in one succinct sentence who you are? What you stand for? The substance of your character. You know, when we meet somebody new in our culture, we tend to say what we do instead of who we really are. You know, so somebody says, oh, hi, so tell me about yourself. And we go right into, oh, well, I'm an insurance agent, or I'm a nurse, or I'm a stay-at-home mom, I'm a teacher. Whatever we say what we do, we don't say who we are. I think a lot of the times it's because we don't really have a good sense of that to begin with. And that's really sad, because who you are, who you really are, informs your purpose, informs your life. It will help you, knowing that and being able to communicate it to others, helps you to choose the people you want to be around. It helps others to choose to be with you, to get closer to you, to know you better, or not. If you're not their cup of tea, great. Don't waste time with people who really are not your tribe. You know, I'm not saying be mean or rude or anything like that. It's just that, you know, healthy relationships with good people is a big part of living your purpose. It's evidence. We talked about that a couple of podcasts ago. That's one of the measurements of whether or not we're really living in our purpose is, you know, look around at our relationships. Because when you're in your purpose, when you're really living your purpose, you will attract good people into your life. People who share your same values. They're sort of like-minded people. That doesn't mean that you all walk in lockstep. You can have really great relationships with people who don't think the same way that you think, who don't vote the same way that you vote, and on and on. It doesn't mean they're not good people, and it doesn't mean that they don't share certain things with you. But in those kinds of relationships, what I want to talk about today, about being you and modeling what it's like to be your authentic, unique self, modeling that for other people becomes even more important when you have people in your life who don't share every single value, who don't share your faith, who don't share your belief system. So let's talk about what we tend to do in this time that we live in this culture. And maybe it's been true in for all of time and in every culture. I don't know. But I know in our culture, we have a tendency to follow other people, to model what other people do. Maybe we do it consciously, maybe we don't. But the bottom line is that to some degree, we sort of conform to the people and culture around us. And here's what I mean by that. So, you know, through the years, there'll be, you know, a certain kind of a haircut. And a lot of women go out and get that haircut. Many of us go for the whole fashion thing. Like, okay, well, skinny jeans are in. I'm going to go get skinny jeans. Yep, that's the thing. That's the style. Let's have skinny jeans. Well, I mean, my example of that, my goodness, my legs are more like tree trunks than branches. So I have no business on earth being in skinny jeans. So I literally just can't conform to, you know, every style. But hopefully you get my point that when, okay, so wide leg pants are in, you know, and we just, a lot of us flock over and buy the wide leg pants. And the same is true for men too. If you think about like men's suits, okay, you have, in some years you have suits with super skinny lapels and then the lapels get wider. And there've been times, I don't know, in the 70s when the lapels are super wide, ties get wide, ties get skinnier. And we're like lemons, you know, we just flop, oh, skinny tie. Oh, wide tie is out. Let's not get caught wearing the thing that's out. Like it would be the worst thing on earth, right? And so we follow these trends. And I've always thought, like, who in the world decides this? Who? And I guess it's the influencers of the world. You know, somebody who has a million followers, you know, comes up with wearing a short skirt when longer maxi skirts are in or whatever it is. Somebody breaks out of the mold and then a whole bunch of people follow that person. And I guess that's how it happens. But it's not only about fashion where this happens. This happens with character as well. You know, if we work in a company where the, you know, part of the camaraderie is everybody goes for drinks on Friday after work, you may find yourself going for drinks on Friday after work. Even if you're somebody who doesn't go to bars, even if you're somebody who doesn't drink and doesn't like that kind of thing, if that's the company culture in which you work, eventually it's going to be the boss's birthday or it's going to be a retirement thing or it's going to be something where you literally are pressured into going and complying with the norm. The norm, there it is, right? A lot of these things are harmless, and I'm not trying to suggest that, you know, we shouldn't participate in some of this stuff, but I think we can get lost in it. If you think about the young people who, you know, do their hair bright pink or blue or purple or whatever. And it's not just young people. It's, you know, it can be people my age too. The nose piercings, the nose ring, the tattoos. And I think, okay, are you just following? Are you trying to be part of something? I remember there was a time when it was super cool to go get a tattoo of, I don't know if it was Chinese writing, Japanese writing, I don't know. And I remember just seeing people I knew, white people who didn't speak that language and they are not part of that culture. And now they have, you know, the big, whatever it was, Chinese writing, Japanese writing, obviously some other language writing. And you say, well, what does it mean? And they really don't know. Somebody told them it meant this. And so they did it. And I think, oh my gosh, I mean, that's just so disingenuous because what is that about? Somebody else did it. And it looked cool. Cool. What's cool? I guess we've all probably followed the cool kids at some point in life. But how many people followed the cool kids into drugs, sex, parties they shouldn't have been at, doing things they shouldn't have done? Those kinds of things, you know, a lot of people kind of laugh it off like, oh, well, you know, that was then and that was my younger years and whatever. Okay, fine. But for some people, those kinds of things, those moments changed the trajectory of their lives. And that's not even to mention the whole, you know, everything being laced with fentanyl now. And so that one moment could be the last moment. The point is that we get away from who we really are. Are any of those things who you really are? You know, probably not. I think about when I moved to Orange County, California. I'm from Southern California, fourth generation Californian, but Orange County is a whole, you know, the OC, you know, there's just a whole, it was a different culture than what I was used to. And when I say that, I mean, for example, plastic surgery was really common. I wasn't used to that. And so there were just a lot of people walking around who looked perfect. There were some people who looked like they had gotten addicted to plastic surgery and didn't have a really good friend in their life who would take them aside and say, enough, enough is enough. But, you know, it wasn't a super common thing where I was from. All of a sudden, I saw handbags that were worth more than what was inside the handbag. That was kind of a new thing for me. Seeing people walk around, and I thought seeing people walk around with a Louis Vuitton handbag that cost $3,000. I just thought, well, this is just ridiculous. Gosh, $3,000 would buy a lot of shoes for a lot of homeless kids. And then I found out about Hermes Birkin bags that go for over $100,000. So, you know, it depends on, I guess, which culture you happen to be immersed in, what's popular. But I really saw it. I really felt that thing where, and I would joke around like, oh, okay, you know, like when Tesla cars came out and they were so popular, and where I lived in Newport Coast, I would joke and say, well, Tesla, the official vehicle of Newport Coast. And because everybody had a Tesla and they didn't make a sound, so you could be walking and somebody's flying out of their driveway and you didn't hear it. I mean, I don't know how many times I could have gotten run over by a Tesla. And just the, I don't know, cocktail parties and, you know, just things like that that weren't even a thing where I came from. They were a thing. Similar to people who go to New York, and it's really only a matter of time before almost the entire wardrobe becomes black. That's sort of the uniform for people who live in New York City. I moved to Southern Nevada, and I've worn suits since, oh my goodness, the very first brand new article of clothing I ever had when I was 13 years old was a suit. I love suits. I moved to Nevada and nobody wears suits. Partly because 3 months out of the year, you know, it's the gateway of hell. It's so hot, you can't wear a suit. But it's just not a thing here. People just don't do that. And I found myself conforming. Natural enough, because you don't want to wear a suit to things where other people are in really casual clothes. I don't want to make anybody feel like you're trying to come in and take over. That's what it looks like. It looks like a power suit. And it looks like you just expect to walk in and be large and in charge and, you know, take over those. So what did I do? The suits are hanging in the closet and I conformed to the culture. So I'm not saying there's anything really wrong with doing that. But we have to really make an effort to be ourselves while we make adjustments so that we're not off-putting to other people. But it's important to be who we are, even when that's different from the culture. And the reason is your identity. Your authentic identity is different from anyone else. Why imitate others or mimic others in terms of looks and actions, attitudes, behaviors, when you could just be you? You're awesome. You are. You might not think so. You might think of a lot of us do. We think of all of our flaws, all the things. So, you know, all the things that are wrong, all the things we would like to change about ourselves. But who you are, your personality, your character, your skills, your perspective, all of that is uniquely you. Have your own look. Don't mimic somebody else and be a cheap imitation of somebody that is some celebrity or influencer. I've seen so many people go into debt to buy, I don't know, Christian Loubitan shoes or Chanel handbag or whatever, because they're trying to fit in. You don't have to fit in. Stop trying to fit in. Be you. Think about the people in your life who you've admired. It could be somebody who achieved something great, or somebody who has always been there for you, or they've been there for people in their lives. It could be a parent, it could be a grandparent, an aunt or an uncle. It can be your favorite teacher, your coach, your favorite boss. Think of people in your life who are honest, who have integrity, who are, they operate with wisdom. They do good. They're kind. They're nice. They're fun. If you're going to model somebody, model those people. Now, if you don't have anybody in your life like that, think of somebody in history or somebody that you've read about, a very successful person, a very kind or loving person. Think of somebody who, and it could be several people, could be a combination of people that you will model. Could be Mother Teresa. Very loving, right? She said, what did she say? We can't all do great things, but we can all do small things with great love. I really am fascinated by hearing about the lives of the disciples of Jesus. If you haven't seen the TV series, The Chosen, take a look at that. And don't give up on it. The first couple of episodes, yeah, I don't know, you might feel like moves a little bit slowly, but by the third episode, I don't know, I was hooked. So it gives you sort of a glimpse of the lives of the people Jesus chose as his followers. You can look at their lives. Another thing that I like to do is look at the lives of the saints. These are some really fascinating people. Really, some of them very accomplished. Some of them, we don't know a whole lot about, but what we do know is really profound. So, you know, I think about people, for me anyway, who I want to model, people of substance who did what they thought was right, regardless of who approved, regardless of who liked it or who didn't. Those are the people I want to model. Because I don't need consensus or approval from the culture in order to do what I think I was put here to do. See, that's the whole key to all of this. As you might be thinking, oh my gosh, she's belaboring the point, sorry. But the point really is, if you have the courage to just be who you authentically are, then you will also have the courage to do what you were put here to do. See, when I quit my job, my good job that had the steady paycheck and the health insurance and, you know, all of that, stability, to start my own company, I was 27 years old. I had no family. I had no money. I had no safety net. I had no real stability in my life. I just didn't look Like there was nothing about me that said, oh, you know, she'll be fine. She'll land on her feet. There was nothing like that. So quitting my job and starting my own business didn't appear to be a good idea. The people I was around in my life at that time thought I was nuts. So if I was somebody who followed the crowd and wanted the approval of the people in my life, I probably would not have quit my job and started my own business. And that would have, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what my life would have turned out like, because starting my business led me to, oh gosh, I could go on and on. The man I married, a person who became my sister-in-law, all of my husband's family, all of the friends that I've had over decades, who are social workers and psychologists and pastors, people who have dedicated their lives to caring for children who have been mistreated. These are some of the best people in the world. And if I hadn't quit my job and started my company, which was all about protecting and defending the good people and organizations that take care of children who have been abused and their broken and dysfunctional families, if I hadn't done that, I wouldn't have made all of those friends. I wouldn't have those amazing, deep, substantive relationships with some of the best people on earth. And how sad that would have been to spend my life in a career that didn't have that meaning and purpose for me. I knew it. I knew that I was supposed to do that when I worked really, really hard to place the insurance for a guy who owned convalescent care facilities. And I worked really hard, and I negotiated a premium savings for him. And I was taking the insurance policy to him. He wanted it delivered. And I remember pulling up to his amazing mansion. And there were two brand new Porsches in their driveway, in the circular driveway. And I walked up to the door and I opened the door, and I don't know, I was young. I expected him to say, oh my gosh, thank you so much for saving us that money. That was great. You know, oh, you worked so hard, or would it, like, give me a little pat on the back. I wanted that. And he opened the door and I said, hi, I brought your policy. And gosh, I was so excited to save you that money, or whatever I said. And he said, yeah, thanks. And he grabbed the papers out of my hand and closed the door. And I'm standing there on the step of this mansion, like, wow, this was my hard work. It was not appreciated. It clearly, because of what I was seeing about his lifestyle, and hey, I don't think there's anything wrong with having a mansion and two Porsches. I'm not talking about, I mean, I'm a capitalist, whatever. I'm sure he worked hard for whatever he had. But the point is that I wasn't valued. What I had done was not appreciated. And on the other hand, when I would take care of the insurance for what we called back then a home for abused children, I mean, sometimes people would weep. Oh, thank you so much for what you did. This is amazing. This puts money back in the budget. We were going to have to spend this on insurance, and now we can spend it on, you know, and they would name the amazing things that they were now going to be able to do for the kids in their care because of what I had done. And that fed my soul. So I would have missed out on all of that if I would have followed the crowd and followed the prevailing wisdom. But because I had read about the lives of some amazing people who risked their lives to do what they thought was right, what they felt led to do. I had the courage to do what I felt led to do. It was scary to quit my job and take that leap. And I'm not suggesting that everybody who listens to this just quit your job and take a leap. No, don't do it. Pray and really be confident about what you feel like you were made to do, what you're meant to do, what you're passionate about. Talk to people you trust and get some feedback. But that doesn't mean do exactly as somebody else directs you. You might be like me, where everybody in your life says you are nuts. But if you feel led to do it, if you feel a conviction to do it, after you've prayed and really sought direction and really thought about who you are, who you really are, if it turns out that what you feel led to do is categorically opposite of what everybody in your life thinks you should do, well, I mean, if it comes down to follow God or follow people, I'm going to always follow God. And that's what I'm suggesting you do. If you will be you, the authentic, real you, with the character traits that God gave you, with the personality that God gave you, not where you have to tone it down or you have to change it or you have to reel yourself in around people. If you will just let it rip and be who you were made to be, who God Himself made you to be, and go in the direction that God Himself created for you to go, then you cannot lose. You cannot fail. Good relationships will come to you. You will have peace. You will have joy. I mean, you'll have a hoot. It'll be a hoot doing what you were made to do. You'll have a sense of contentedness that you can't get any other way. That's what I found in pursuing God's purpose for my life. And you know, there might be different life assignments within your purpose. That's what happened for me. I thought I was going to insure child welfare organizations for the rest of my life, and they would just carry me out in a box when I was done. And that's not what happened. There was another assignment. I sold that company. I started Successful Survivors Foundation, an educational 501c3 organization to help survivors create successful lives. And I started writing in order to help people. I knew that when you write a book or make a podcast, when you create content, the content goes on beyond you. So long after I'm gone, this podcast will still be out there. The books that I've written will go on beyond me. And my hope and my prayer is that somewhere along the line, maybe it's, you know, somebody suffering at 2 o'clock in the morning alone, and somebody has given them one of my books. And they pick up the book and they read it, and I'm speaking directly to them. And my hope would be that I've lived a good enough life with integrity, with perseverance, with resilience, with resourcefulness, with kindness, and with love, that when someone who's hurting reads my words, will choose to model me. See, when you become your authentic self, when you let her rip and you follow God's leading for your life, you will be a model to everyone within your influence. if you have courage to step out and do what God created you to do, you'll inspire others to dig deep and find the courage to do what they're meant to do. That's the point. We can model purposeful behavior, purposeful choices. And when we're living our purpose, not only is it fun and does it feel good and do you have great relationships with other people, but to know that you can have an impact on the lives of others, it just makes your life that much sweeter. So that's it for this week. Check back with me next week. I hope that you'll share this and subscribe and comment so that more people will quit mimicking others, quit imitating whatever's in the culture, and step into being themselves, their authentic identity, and living out their purpose and having the full impact in the world of their purpose. And they'll do it not because of me, but because of you living your purpose. So let's keep at it. See you next week.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.